Welcome back, students. In this lesson, we're going to continue learning about the rise of totalitarian dictators by looking at the growth of fascism in Germany and the rise to power of Adolf Hitler.
After World War I, Germany was actually a surprisingly progressive country, possibly one of the most progressive in the world. Rule by the Kaiser had been replaced after World War I, when Kaiser Wilhelm stepped down, by the democratically elected Weimar Republic. Within the Weimar Republic, you see a huge expansion of civil rights. For example, women get the right to vote a few years before they do in the United States. There's also a strong LGBTQ rights movement, including trans rights. One of the first areas for medical research into transgender issues was in Germany during the Weimar Republic. So this is a level of progressiveness and expansion of civil rights on par with what we're experiencing in the modern time. You also see widespread protection of freedom of speech and a culture that celebrated the Jazz Age. The Jazz Age had just started in America with the Harlem Renaissance, and jazz music and the free living lifestyle that was associated with it also caught on in a big way in Germany. However, underlying this celebratory culture, there was a lot of problems. Within this democratic government, there weren't any real dominant political parties. Instead, there was lots of small parties all fighting for power, which led to a lot of political instability. Also, there was a big cultural divide between rural communities in Germany and what was happening in the cities. The cities were enjoying this vibrant jazz age, but out in the countryside, people were really struggling with the economic after effects of World War I and were feeling alien and forgotten by these rapidly changing urban culture. And then there was the Treaty of Versailles that we learned about in the last unit. So the big ideas for the Treaty of Versailles is it's the treaty that Germany was forced to sign at the end of World War I, and it blames Germany and punishes it for World War I. And this is something that the German people are going to be extremely unhappy with, especially because they had shown up at the Paris Peace Conference expecting Woodrow Wilson's 14 points, which was all about peace without blame. The other allies, Britain and France, reject that and instead heap punishment on Germany with the Treaty of Versailles. It was the Weimar government that had signed the Treaty of Versailles, so a lot of the German people, in addition to being angry at Britain and France for forcing them into it, were also upset with the Weimar government for signing it. They feel like the Weimar government signing the Treaty of Versailles was a betrayal of the German people by their own government. And you start to see a lot of political rhetoric that describes the Weimar government as sort of stabbing the good, hard-working soldiers in the back. Now, at that time, Germany was already clearly losing, but that's not something that the people making this argument are really going to acknowledge. Tied up with the end of World War I, there are also huge economic problems in Germany. Just because the war's over doesn't mean that food magically comes into existence. The economy, the supply lines, the farms are going to take a long time to recover, so there's going to be massive food shortages. There's also going to be high unemployment, as factories aren't producing as much because they're not trying to supply the German war machine with the artillery, with the weapons. Also, there's more people vying for jobs as soldiers return home after the war. And this combination of fewer job opportunities with a larger number of people seeking jobs is going to cause unemployment, just like we saw with Italy. A unique problem that Germany faces, though, is in addition to these built-in economic problems, they also have the war reparations that they have to pay as part of the Treaty of Versailles, a steep fine that the Allies placed on Germany. Germany's economy is already in trouble. They don't have the money to pay this fine back, so they just print money. They don't have anything to back this money up with. It's just paper. And laws of supply and demand, as you produce more of something, its value plummets. This printing of massive amounts of money to pay back the Treaty of Versailles war reparations causes inflation on a level that the world had never seen before. To give you a sense of scale, in 1920, one US dollar was worth about 40 Deutschmarks. That's the German currency at the time. By 1923, one US dollar was worth this many Deutschmarks. And that's such a big number that you've almost got to count it out by place value. It's like, all right, here's thousands, millions, billions, trillions. For one US dollar, you could get 4,200,000,000,000 Deutschmarks, which basically meant that people's life savings were no longer worth anything. If someone had $1 billion before the war, they went into the war as a billionaire, it's worth like barely a penny now. And there's all of these insane photos coming out of Weimar Republic Germany showing just how useless the money is. Here's a guy trying to buy a loaf of bread at a local grocery store, and the price of bread is now so high that it's not even worth it to count out the individual paper dollars. Instead, they are weighing the money. Here's children just stacking up Deutschmarks, using them almost as building blocks, because they've become so worthless. Here's people making paper kites, more children just playing with bundles of cash. This person is wallpapering their house with it, and this lady is burning Deutschmarks as fuel to heat her house because they are literally not worth the paper that they are printed on. Basically, German currency is now worthless, and that is going to make their economic problems even worse. This means that people are going to be in a state of desperation and anger. This makes them very easy pickings for political manipulation. And this is when Adolf Hitler is going to enter the scene. Adolf Hitler was a veteran of World War I. There he is. He actually nearly died in the war due to a poison gas attack. He was caught in a mustard gas attack. And that's one of the reasons for his smaller mustache that you see later. Those type of mustaches don't interfere with the gas masks as much.
Hitler was actually in the hospital recovering from this mustard gas attack when the Treaty of Versailles was signed, and he's going to be one of those politicians who makes the argument that the Treaty of Versailles was a betrayal of the German people by the Weimar government. It wasn't the soldiers who lost the war, it was the cowards in the government who lost it. Despite the fact that Germany was already thoroughly losing by the time that Kaiser Wilhelm stepped down and the Weimar Republic took over.
But remember, one of the trademarks of fascist political rhetoric is not being concerned with fact or reality, and much more playing into emotion. So it's telling people, you're not to blame for what's going on right now, it's the Weimar Republic that's at fault, is a really easy emotional argument that's going to appeal to desperate and angry people. He's going to join the National Socialist German Workers Party, aka the Nazis. Now, this term National Socialism sometimes causes confusion. A lot of people look at it and they say, oh, so it's a socialist. Nazis were socialists. No. National Socialism is different than socialism. Just like anti-venom is different than venom. Just because it has the same word in it doesn't mean it's the same thing. In fact, National Socialism is a party that's set up in opposition to socialism. They reject Marxist ideas of equality and instead says that the individual is not as important as the well-being of the nation. It's the same fascist ideology that we saw with Mussolini. Individual rights and well-being are not as important as the power and strength of the country. Hitler's rhetoric of you're not to blame the Weimar Republic, is very appealing, and the Nazi Party is going to continue to grow. It's going to be particularly appealing to unhappy veterans, and as the Nazi Party grows, you're going to see him using the exact same playbook that we saw Mussolini using in Italy. Hitler was actively studying and intentionally copying what Mussolini was doing. For example, Mussolini had his black shirts, his street gang enforcers. Hitler has the brown shirts, also known as the SA. In terms of what made the Nazi Party so popular, these are their basic party platform. 1. Reject the Treaty of Versailles. The Treaty of Versailles was unfair, it was a betrayal of the German people, and therefore it should be gotten rid of. Also, expanding Germany.
As a growing world power, Hitler very much used the United States as a model for what he wanted to make Germany into, and he accurately pointed out that a big source of America's power was westward expansion and the sheer amount of land that the United States was able to claim. He wanted to grow Germany in a similar way, building a third German empire or a Third Reich. The Second Empire being Germany before its downfall in World War I, and the First Empire being the medieval Holy Roman Empire established by Charlemagne, or even going all the way back to the Roman Empire. Because, like all of the fascists that we're going to be learning about, Hitler and the Nazis are obsessed with Rome.
Before World War I, Germany had been one of the most powerful European countries. Hitler is saying that under his leadership, Germany will be able to reclaim that former glory. Tied in with this idea of German greatness. They tie German identity to racial identity, specifically this idea of an Aryan people, blonde-haired, blue-eyed. All of that is completely made up. There is no Aryan race. There is a group in ancient India known as the Aryans, but they have nothing to do with the German people. You want to know how that term got spread to Germany? It had to do with this weird magic mystic cult that got really into Indian Hindu beliefs. Some high-ranking Nazi officials get into this cult and they're like, we like this weird mysticism, but we're going to get rid of the Indian connections because we're super racist, and instead we're going to say that Aryan is this German identity. It's not an actual thing. As the Nazi Party increases in power, Hitler decides that he's going to make a bid for control, just like Mussolini did. So we saw in Italy yesterday, Mussolini having this army of black shirts march on the Italian government. Hitler's going to try the same thing with his brown shirts in the 1923 Beer Hall Putsch. The Beer Hall Putsch was called this because it started in a bar. Basically, a group of brown shirts are going to try to seize the German government in Munich. This is not going to go as well for Hitler as it did for Mussolini. This attempt at a coup, and a coup is a overthrow of the government, is going to be stopped by police. Hitler is arrested and thrown in jail. Now, this is a famous incident in Hitler's life because it's when he writes Mein Kampf. And a lot of times when people describe him writing Mein Kampf, this book where he lays out his plans for restoring German greatness, they say, and he wrote it in prison. And people imagine him in this dark, cramped jail cell, suffering, scribbling it out. The reason I put jail under quotation marks is he was basically placed under house arrest in a castle with all of his friends. This is a picture of him serving his jail sentence out. This is a really mild punishment for someone who just attempted to violently overthrow the German government. After serving out his quote-unquote jail sentence, Hitler decides to change tactics and try to gain political power through election instead of some sort of violent coup. So he focuses on propaganda and recruiting instead of violent insurrection. Here he is posing with his own personal fascist youth group, the Hitler Youth. And Hitler's propaganda machine was incredibly influential in Germany at the time. There's actually a recent movie that came out that's quite good called Jojo Rabbit that's about this. It focuses on a young boy who grew up in Nazi Germany at the time and how his worldviews have been shaped by the propaganda.
Here's Master Jojo, you're a pup man. Prepare to leave the house.
Today you boys will be involved in such activities as war games, ambush techniques, Zimbleinstuffer.
I don't think I can do this.
Was? Of course you can.
When I was your age, I had an imaginary friend. Got me in so much trouble.
Kids, it's time to burn some books.
You're growing up too fast. 10-year-olds shouldn't be celebrating war and talking politics.
Hitler. I wish more of our young boys had your blind fanaticism.
Did you know Jews can read each other's minds?
But how would you know if you saw one? They could look just like us.
Hi. You know what I am?
Say it.
A Jew. Gesundheit.
Jeez, that was intense.
What am I going to do?
No idea.
Got it! I will negotiate.
Burn down the house and blame Winston Churchill. We'll negotiate.
If I tell on you, you'll be in big trouble.
They'll never win. Love is the strongest thing in the world.
Your mother took me in. She's kind. She treats me like a person.
You two seem to be getting on well.
She doesn't seem like a bad person. I'm the enemy. You're not a Nazi, Jojo. You're a 10-year-old kid who likes dressing up in a funny uniform and wants to be part of a club. Yogi?
Oh, God. Nothing makes sense anymore.
Yeah, I know. It's definitely not a good time to be a Nazi.
Hitler's propaganda has a lot of eager ears because things are getting even worse in Germany. Germany was in rough shape by the end of World War I, and then it gets hit by the Great Depression. Remember, the Great Depression that the U.S. experienced in the 1920s was not just confined to the U.S., and it makes things even worse in Germany. One of the few things that had been propping the German economy up at the time had been U.S. aid. The U.S. had been sending relief, financial support, food supplies to Germany. Now that gets cut off because the U.S. has problems at home that it needs to take care of. Unemployment skyrockets to 30%, meaning roughly one out of every three adults who are trying to find a job cannot. This is also going to be coupled with massive food shortage as Germany's farming and infrastructure is still trying to recover from World War I. So there's no food, there's no jobs, and there's no foreign support. Nazi propaganda is going to take this desperate situation and give people scapegoats, people to blame for their plight. You're not at fault for what's happening. The fault is the Treaty of Versailles, forced on us by Britain and France, the Weimar government for betraying the German people and accepting the Treaty of Versailles, also communists because they're the current boogeymen at the time, and Jews because they are always an easy group to scapegoat. They're a minority group, which leaves them vulnerable, and the fact that they're from a different culture and may seem strange and other to the German people make them easy targets for suspicion and blame. So you see a lot of propaganda like this, sometimes even saying that Jewish people and communists are working together, despite the fact that communists were also targeting and persecuting Jews within Russia. In addition to giving people someone to blame, a target for their rage and frustration, the Nazi Party also offers hope. They say, put us in charge and we will restore Germany to its former greatness. We will bring back German prosperity and German pride. This is going to push Nazi popularity further. This is exactly what the desperate and put upon German people are willing to hear. In 1932, the Nazis are going to win the most seats in the Reichstag. That's basically Germany's parliament. They are not going to have a majority, but they are going to control more seats than any other political party. As the leader of the Nazi Party, Hitler is going to be appointed chancellor, which is the top cabinet position, the most powerful position in parliament, by President of Germany Hindenburg. If Hindenburg sounds familiar, he was a major German general during World War I. He's not a big fan of Hitler, but given the Nazi Party's popularity, he feels like he doesn't have a choice. It's that or risk an uprising from the Nazi Party. That could do a lot of damage to Germany, so Hindenburg is going to give Hitler this powerful position, just like the King of Italy gave Mussolini a position of power in hopes of avoiding civil unrest. And just like Mussolini, Hitler is going to use this position of power to grow his strength. His big move is going to be the 1933 incident, the Reichstag fire, where basically an important government building, the building that parliament meets in, the Reichstag, catches on fire. Hitler blames the communists. He says that this is a communist plot, an attack on Germany, and I need emergency powers, and he's able to convince the Reichstag, so the Reichstag being the group of people, not the physical building that just caught on fire, to give him emergency powers, to give him even more political power. Now, he's blaming the communists. It's unclear exactly who actually started the Reichstag fire. Given that Joseph Stalin was the leader of the Soviet Union, the main communist country at the time, it's entirely possible that he ordered this terrorist attack on Germany. At the same time, it's entirely possible that Hitler himself ordered the Reichstag fire to give him an excuse to claim greater power in the German government. Both actions would be completely in line with both Joseph Stalin and Adolf Hitler's way of doing things. Who actually started the Reichstag fire isn't nearly as important as what happens as a consequence of the Reichstag fire and the granting of these emergency powers to Hitler. He uses these emergency powers to solidify political power. He bans all non-Nazi political parties. There is now no other political party in Germany except for the Nazi Party. He also dissolves labor unions, claiming that they were just agents of the Russian communist government, meaning he's taking away the power that the working class had to try and advocate for themselves. He's able to expand his power further when, in the following year, President Hindenburg dies. Instead of electing a new German president, Hitler combines both the position of president that Hindenburg had and his position of chancellor into a new all-powerful government position known as the Führer, or the leader. 1934 is also going to see an event known as the Night of the Long Knives, in which Hitler eliminates all possible political rivals, including rivals within the Nazi Party itself. This includes the leader of the SA, the leader of the Brown Shirts, this fellow right here, and the SA is disbanded. He decides that even they could pose too much of a threat, and replaces them with the Schutzstaffel, also known as the SS. These are going to act as Hitler's own personal private army. All members of the SS swear personal loyalty to Hitler himself. They answer to him and nothing else in the German government, and they have absolute power to arrest anyone they deem enemies of the state. Backing the SS is going to be this more secretive, shadowy police force known as the Gestapo. In the face of this growing power and brutality, a lot of the opposition to the Nazi government flees or are killed. In terms of the general German people, a lot of them are going to accept Nazi rule for similar reasons that we saw people accepting Mussolini's fascist rule in Italy. They're just tired. Things are hard in Germany at the time, and they're willing to ignore what's going on to other people in Germany because their daily life is getting better. Unemployment is dropping. The economy is starting to mend. Reasons for that are public building projects paid for by the Nazi government, and as the Nazi government starts expanding its military power, factories are ramping back up, creating more factory jobs. So under the Nazi Party's rule, things for the average German citizen are going to seem to be improving, and they're willing to accept this and not pay too much attention to where this is coming from. A lot of these improvements are going to be funded by the brutal persecution of the Jewish people during this time. We're going to learn about the Holocaust as its own separate lecture at the end of this unit, but in addition to the murder of Jewish people in Germany at the time, all of their possessions are also being stolen. The funding for these public works projects and increased manufacturing is coming from things stolen from the Jewish people. Their businesses, they're losing their lands, their life savings are being stolen, and as Jewish people are going to be sent to these concentration camps, things even like wedding rings and gold fillings are going to be taken from. This is where a lot of the infamous Nazi gold comes from. And to give you a scale of just how much is being stolen from the Jewish people, when the Nazi Party took over, Germany's national gold reserve was only around 25 tons of gold. From a single city alone, 10 tons of gold was taken from the local Jewish population, and this is going to be happening everywhere. So even though it looks like the Nazi Party is helping Germany's economy, they are doing this through horrific means. But for the average German people, they're willing to ignore this. And there's a famous quote that comes out of Germany in the aftermath of what happens in the Holocaust that kind of sums up this attitude, which is, "First they came for the socialists, and I did not speak out because I was not a socialist. Then they came for the trade unionists, and I did not speak out because I was not a trade unionist. Then they came for the Jews, and I did not speak out because I was not a Jew. Then they came for me, and there was no one left to speak for me." And that's what's going to sum up Hitler's rise to power. He's going to initially appeal to a broad base and only persecute people who are seen as minority groups or others by the general population. And the general population is willing to ignore these atrocities because it's not affecting them personally. And in fact, the theft of these persecuted people's goods is making their lives better. However, as this happens, Hitler is cementing his power more and more. He's taken away rights from larger and larger groups of people, and eventually hardships are going to affect the entire German population. But by the time it starts affecting the average German, it is too late for them to do anything because Hitler has already solidified his power. There will be many Germans who do try to resist Hitler's rise to power. I'll be posting a podcast for this unit shortly, and there's going to be a really interesting one about the Order of the White Rose, a group of students that try to resist this, but there's not going to be widespread resistance until it is too late.
And that is where we're going to stop this lesson. Like you did with Italy, take a few minutes to use your notes to fill out the Germany section of the totalitarian dictator chart, and feel free to get in touch if you need any help.